My name is Jason Yeh, and I'm in my last year of an OBGYN residency at Duke University. This talk is an overview of PCOS. Our objectives are to understand the history of PCOS. Also, we will talk about how the mechanisms of how PCOS develops. It will also be important to discuss how to work up and treat PCOS and its related comorbidities. PCOS was first characterized in 1935 by Dr. Stein and Leventhal. They collected a series of patients that had demonstrated signs and symptoms of hirsutism, obesity, amenorrhea, and oligomenorrhea. They also had polycystic ovaries, and because of this, it was felt that this was probably the cause of their problems. It was later found that these women had menstrual cycles restored with partial ovarian resections, and therefore PCOS really stuck as the name and likely cause of the disease. However, since then, we've realized that having polycystic ovaries is not necessary, and some patients don't have the ovarian findings, but have everything else. Therefore, lots of meetings have been made to secure a good definition of PCOS. In 1990, the NIH decided that you need all three to diagnose PCOS, which include oligoovulation, signs and symptoms of androgen excess, and you need to exclude other things that could cause PCOS. In 2003, a meeting in Rotterdam suggests that you need two of three things to diagnose PCOS. Those are oligoovulation / anovulation, excess androgen activity, or polycystic ovaries by ultrasound. Of note, polycystic ovaries can be diagnosed with 12 or more follicles in one ovary, with follicles ranging anywhere from 2 to 9 millimeters, and or an increase in total ovarian volume greater than 10 cc's. First, it's important to say that no one is entirely clear what starts the PCOS process, but in order to understand how PCOS may come about, we need to talk about the two-cell and two-gonadotropin theory. The key players are follicle-stimulating hormone, FSH, and luteinizing hormone, LH, which are released from the gonadotropes in the anterior pituitary of the brain. Imagine a sphere-shaped follicle with an outside cell layer and an inside cell layer. There's also a basement membrane in between. The cells on the outside are the theca cells, which have LH receptors. There's also another layer of cells on the inside of the membrane called granulosa cells, which have FSH receptors. So the key to understanding this is that the two cells work together to convert cholesterol to estrogen. First, LH stimulates the theca cells, which responds by taking cholesterol and converts it to androgens, specifically testosterone and androstenedione. There is no significant amount of aromatase in the theca cells, so the process of conversion stops at the androgen level. Then, the androgens are then small enough to cross the membrane and get into the granulosa cells. These granulosa cells respond to FSH and have lots of aromatase, which then allows the conversion of androgen to estrogen. So ultimately, the process of converting cholesterol to estrogens requires two cells and two separate hormones. If you have a defect in either cell, you don't have a balanced process. So now that we've established how the synthesis of androgens and estrogens happens, we can talk about how PCOS starts. No one really knows what starts the process, but it's believed that it's caused by a poor balance of FSH to LH. On one hand, if you have too much LH secretion, you have ovarian theca cells stimulated to make androgens. Lots of LH therefore makes lots of androgens and overloads the capacity of the granulosa cells to aromatize into estrogens. On the other hand, it may also be possible that there is not enough FSH, and therefore your conversion to estrogen is too slow and you get a backup and buildup of androgens. When you don't have enough estrogen, a woman may progress to anovulation, which is an important characteristic of PCOS. PCOS is one of the most common disorders in endocrinology. In the USA, it affects anywhere from 4 to 12% of people. In Europe, it's probably closer to 6 to 8%. If you remember the way you diagnose it from the first slide, there are not a lot of specific clinical features. This is meant to provide lots of flexibility in the diagnosis. Therefore, the physical presentation is very varied. For example, if an Asian and Caucasian have the same hyperandrogen levels, the Asian will overall have much less hair. Also, people think that PCOS patients need to be obese, but there's also a non-obese type of presentation. Also, the inheritance for PCOS is unclear, but a few familial studies suggest that it may actually be autosomal dominant. Unfortunately, there are no specific genes that have been identified that definitely cause PCOS. Although people can present with varied symptoms, there's a typical presentation for the average PCOS patient. Most patients are obese. They typically have oligomenorrhea, which means bleeding less frequent than the normal woman with a cycle length between 35 days and 6 months. They could also have secondary amenorrhea, which is no bleeding for 6 months. They also have symptoms of hyperandrogenism, which such as deepening voice, clitoromegaly, acne, and abnormal or excessive hair growth. Once you have suspected PCOS, you need to rule out all other diseases that could be confusing and confounding the clinical picture. Congenital adrenal hyperplasia is a disease where there is a defective 21-hydroxylase enzyme. This deficiency is a defect in the steroid hormone pathway. Some cases are so severe that it presents as a newborn, but when the enzyme is not entirely defective and it partially works, the disease can actually present later in life in the early reproductive years. When the enzyme is defective, steroid precursors build up. So if you look at your steroid hormone pathway, the precursors that build up are progesterone, 17-hydroxypregnenolone, 17-hydroxyprogesterone. Blood levels of 17-OHP can reach up to 10 to 1,000 times the normal concentration. These excess precursors actually overload the entire system and result in excessive synthesis of androgens. When it presents later in life, the elevated precursor levels are sometimes not detectable until or unless you run a Gonadotropin or ACTH stimulation test. Cushing syndrome can also result in suspected PCOS. A common way to test for this is to run a urine-free cortisol level. There are many ways of testing for this, but this happens to be one of the easiest ways. Hyperprolactinemia needs to be ruled out as well. This can be accomplished with a fasting prolactin level, and if elevated, you'll need to look for causes which include prolactinomas in the brain. Androgen levels also need to be checked to make sure there isn't a tremendous elevation that would suggest an androgen-secreting tumor. Next, the LH and FSH levels could also be checked to rule out the possibility of premature ovarian failure. In PCOS, LH is typically elevated because most people think that is, again, what causes the excessive theca cell stimulation and androgen access. A glucose tolerance test should also be done to look for undiagnosed diabetes because a hallmark of PCOS is actually insulin resistance, and levels become very, very high. Women with PCOS often have diabetes as well as the need to be treated to prevent all the bad outcomes associated with diabetes, such as renal disease, cardiovascular disease, eye disease, etc. Also, imaging studies can also be helpful if there is something you suspect or if there is a need to image the uterus or ovaries to identify any tumors or cysts. So although there is no cure for PCOS, there are a few very important goals for treatment. We will talk about how to do this specifically in the next slide. In general, though, the goals are as follows. The first goal is to prevent endometrial cancer. Next, a clinician should also try to lower insulin levels and either to diagnose or prevent diabetes. Also, it is important to give these patients a chance for fertility restoration when they are ready to start a family, since infertility is very common among PCOS patients. Lastly, treatment of hirsutism and acne is often one of the most frequent complaints that brings patients to the clinic to begin with, so it's important to address this. Treatment of PCOS is a multimodal process and requires an attack on all the different symptoms and disease processes. First, lifestyle modifications is one thing we recommend to many patients. Patients are often anovulatory because of complex interactions of insulin and imbalanced gonadotropins. What is interesting is that diet and exercise that leads to even a modest 5% weight loss is usually enough to resume normal menstrual function. The second is endometrial protection. This is very important because patients who don't have regular cycles are at very high risk of developing endometrial cancer. The goal is therefore to resume normal menstrual cycles or at least give medications enough to stabilize the endometrium. PCOS is a state of excessive estrogen and not enough progestins. The endometrium doesn't have a chance to shed monthly. Therefore, these patients require medications to prevent endometrial hyperplasia that can turn into endometrial cancer. This can be accomplished with oral contraceptives or OCPs, progestin-only pills, a progestin-secreting IUD, progesterone injections, etc. Number three, another common intervention is to give OCPs or oral contraceptives for PCOS. This is done because, number one, it has enough progestin to protect the endometrium against cancer in the future, and two, OCPs increase the sex hormone binding globulin, which then binds to androgens and overall will decrease the free testosterone levels to improve acne and hirsutism. Next, when PCOS patients need to get pregnant, they usually require help. The most common way of inducing ovulation is the use of clomiphene citrate and metformin together. The way this works is a bit beyond the scope of this talk, but if you're interested, please look into it and see how the medication works. Hirsutism and acne is treated in a variety of ways, none of which are permanent. We already talked about how OCPs work. Other treatments include lasers and electrolysis. Also, creams and Retin A are used for acne treatment. Diabetes is often a comorbid diagnosis with PCOS, and if you treat it like you treat non-PCOS patients, that usually works out pretty well. Because insulin resistance is a part of the PCOS pathophysiology, metformin is usually first line since it increases insulin sensitivity. Insulin regimens are added if oral medications are not sufficiently effective. Lastly, an interesting treatment is something called ovarian drilling, where you do laparoscopy to poke holes in the ovary with electrocautery instruments. It's not completely understood why this works, but it's done when PCOS was diagnosed and wedge resections of the ovary were done for histologic analysis. It was noted at that time that these women oftentimes started having normal cycles, so ovarian drilling is just a less morbid and technically easier version of wedge resection. I will conclude this talk with a list of all the associated risks of PCOS and why it's so important that you need to treat the different aspects of such a multimodal disease. This slide is pretty self-explanatory, so there's no need to talk through each one, but just know that if PCOS is left untreated, it can lead to very significant multi-organ system disease. Thank you for your attention.